All right, so we are in this big category of separating processes, and we're going to narrow that down a little bit to this pretty large group of processes, thermal and erosion separating processes. So we'll start with some erosion processes, and we're going to look at ultrasonic machining and water jet cutting, which commonly includes a discussion of abrasive water jet cutting. So all of these are free abrasive processes. We're not going to talk about things like sandblasting or honing, lapping. Those are covered in this other lecture from 1711 Manufacturing Processes 1, Grinding and Abrasive Machining. So there's a link out to there if that's what you're after. But we're going to start with ultrasonic machining. So ultrasonic energy is that energy that happens at frequencies above the threshold that we could hear them. And so these ultrasonic frequencies are useful in manufacturing for other processes like welding, ultrasonic welding, and ultrasonic cleaning, and some others. But you can use ultrasonic machining in conjunction with, or ultrasonic energy in conjunction with this abrasive slurry. So you have a horn here that vibrates a tool up and down at these extremely fast frequencies, very high frequencies, not a lot of amplitude here, as you see, very, very little movement up and down, but very rapid movement back and forth, or up and down. So what you do is you pump this abrasive slurry in between this is your workpiece down here and the tool up here that's vibrating. And what happens is these little abrasive particles will impact the surface of your tool or of your workpiece. And if your workpiece is a nice brittle material, it will just shatter off little tiny bits of the workpiece as it moves down into it. So your tool, like I said, mounted on this device called a horn, which basically takes a frequency and transfers it to the tool. Your tool is mounted down here. Your tool needs to be a softer material that won't be as affected by the impact of the little tiny abrasive particles. So I put in the slides, there is a link out to a sort of promotional video, which is pretty good, pretty explanatory of the process. And if you really want to dig in, there is a 1 hour lecture just on ultrasonic machining right there. But we're just kind of hitting the high points, kind of a survey of processes today. So here are some suitable workpiece materials. Like I said, really hard, brittle materials are best. For a lot of metal materials, you know, EDM, which we'll talk about, well, which we talked about in processes one, is usually the more likely solution. But if you have materials that you cannot EDM, then ultrasonic machining might be a viable option for those. So some advantages: it's non-thermal, so you don't have to worry about a heat-affected zone. Non-chemical, it's all done just, you know, physically. Non-electrical, you get multiple features that can be machined simultaneously, if you have those features already machined into your tooling, for instance. And also you get nice vertical sidewalls, which is something that you might not get with things like chemical machining, which might be an alternative for some machine for some materials. All right, so ultrasonic machining is kind of a niche market. Just kind of a, you know, you use it when you can't use anything else. On the other hand, water jet machining is kind of the opposite of this, or actually abrasive water jet machining, where you take this sort of scenario and you add a little stream of abrasive particles into it. Of just a huge number of materials that you can use water jet machining on, so it's kind of a really nice general purpose cutting process. And at the heart of what's going on with water jet machining is this device here, which is called an intensifier. All right, so an intensifier is all done with this one little equation right here, okay? So you have on this side, you're able to apply pressure here to this piston. So what you do is you have a little small piston, or a hydraulic pressure that's going to push against, let's just say that the area here in this inlet is 1 square inch, so we'll keep things nice and simple. And then we'll say that we're applying a force of maybe 1,000 pounds. So the pressure that would build up in this fluid in here would be 1,000 psi. All right, so that's from our little equation right here. The pressure in this hydraulic fluid is the force divided by the cross-sectional area. So it's 1,000 pounds divided by 1, is 1,000 pounds per square inch. I guess I said that wrong, really. 1,000 pounds divided by 1 square inch is 1,000 pounds per square inch. All right, and then to see what happens on the other side over here, we will just rearrange this equation. So we went through and multiplied both sides by A, and we wind up with A times P is equal to F, and just neaten that up a little bit, say force is equal to the area times the pressure. So that's the force acting out on this other piston. Well, let's just say that this piston has an area, a cross-sectional area, that's normal to this fluid, of 10 square inches. That means that we will have 10 times the pressure, so 10,000 pounds per square inch will give us a force acting out in this direction of 10,000 pounds. So we have 10,000 pounds of force pushing out on this rod, and let's just say that that rod has a smaller diameter. Say it has a diameter that gives us 0.5 square inches. Keep in mind, I'm not saying that's a 0.5 inch diameter, but if we have the area at the end here is 0.5, then we're back to using our pressure equals force per unit area. So come over here and grab that. So the pressure in this little blue zone would be the 10,000 pounds of force divided by the 0.5 inch cross-sectional area. That would give us 20,000 pounds per square inch of pressure on this side. So that's how an intensifier works. And in practice, you generally have even more pressure than that. You may have 30, 60, 90,000 pounds per square inch of water pressure on this other side. And what you do is send that through a little orifice down here made of some extremely hard material like diamond, and you'll get a stream of water that's coming out of here at an extremely high velocity, and it will just erode away pretty much any material that gets in its way. So just with the water, you can, with simply water going out, you can machine a wide variety of materials. But when you start adding this abrasive particle stream in here, then the list of materials goes way, way, way up. So with just plain water jet, you can machine foam, wood, meat, fish, that kind of thing. If you start adding the abrasive particles, there's not much you can't machine. So very, very versatile process. So some of your advantages that are, you know, that it is so darn versatile. You can cut pretty much anything with it. You can cut really large materials with it, thick materials. It has burr-free cutting and no has. That's no heat-affected zone. Now, some of the disadvantages are if you're cutting something like 10-inch thick steel, all right, or really that's kind of way out there, but if you're cutting something like steel and certain other materials, there are going to be better, faster processes for it, all right? But something like oxyacetylene cutting of steel, you know, you're limited pretty much to steel and certain ferrous metals to use oxyacetylene to cut those materials. So it's kind of a trade-off. If you want to go really fast, but you're only cutting steel, you're going to choose something else. If you're cutting a variety of materials, then it makes sense to go ahead and put money into a more versatile process. Also, as you get thicker parts, you start to lose tolerance, and it will cut with a taper, and especially as you go around corners, it will want to kind of taper out as you cut. But there, like I said, there's some pretty good videos on YouTube. This is Fireball channel? Yeah, Fireball Tool. Pretty good channel, and he's got a real good breakdown on abrasive water jet cutting. I also put a video in here of a five-axis machine, so you're not limited to two axes of cutting. I think this, the one that he has up here looks like it's got multiple axes on it as well. So you can actually channel or aim the beam in different directions. So you don't just have X and Y, you also have A and B as well. All right, so these are the thermal separating processes that we're going to talk about. So first we'll start with laser beam cutting. So lasers, pretty good to kind of have a working knowledge of what's going on with a laser, because they're used in a lot of manufacturing processes like welding, additive manufacturing processes like SLA and selective laser sintering, selective laser melting, also used in marking applications, and even in metrology for things like laser interferometry. So I think really the two main principles that that you need to understand, sort of at a very high level, just a general understanding, would be this idea of oscillation and this idea of resonance. Okay, and so, if you put a heavy person onto a swing, even a small child could get a very, an adult on a swing. A small child could get that swing going pretty high if they only push at the right time. All right, so the swinging back and forth is this idea of oscillation, back and forth, and this idea of resonance is giving the push at the right time. All right, so what's happening in a laser is you have some kind of a medium in here, this gain medium, and this could be different kinds of solids, different kinds of liquids even, and even different gases. So you have some kind of a medium in here. And what you do is pump this thing and get it going so that you're exciting this medium in here at a nice consistent rate. You've also constructed this discharge tube with two ends that are mirrored on one end and partially mirrored on the other. And the length of this tube is pretty important. Okay, so it needs to be some number of wavelengths or even half wavelengths of the medium in here, of the light that you're trying to get pumped out of that medium. And so the light comes from this fact, that you take this atom, okay, and what would normally happen in an atom is normally that atom is down at its ground state. So all you really need to understand is that an atom can exist in these different levels, all right? So you have it at one state, or you can take an electron and bump it up a shell or bump it up an energy level and get it to an excited state. So if you happen to have an atom that is in its excited state, it tends to really want to go down to its ground state. But you can take and add, in this case maybe a photon or some source of energy, and you can bump that electron in that atom up to its excited state. All right. So that's, and then what happens if that's struck with a photon? That photon gets canceled out. The energy goes into bumping up that atom to its excited state. On the other hand, if you have an excited electron or excited atom, then the electron can fall down to its ground state and release a photon. So this is what you see going on, like in a neon lamp, for example. Those electrons get excited by the electrical energy being pumped into that tube, and it excites the electrons, and then they fall back down to their ground state, and this photon comes flying out. Well, if you're able to kind of time things just right, you can take an already excited electron that's kind of up here in this sort of tenuous position of being excited, and you can pump an electron or a photon or really any energy in here. It's done different ways, but let's just think of it as being a photon. So we can have a photon come in here and knock that already excited electron down to its ground state at a specific time. Okay, and so that means that you get, since it was already excited, you don't cancel out that photon. You keep that original photon, but you get an extra photon out because the atom was already excited, and so it drops down to the ground state, releases that photon, and so you get more light out of this. And so this is an amplification process, and so laser stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. All right, so I think I got that right. All right, and so here's our arrangement. Okay, you've got this gain medium in here, and that's what you're going to be exciting. You have some way to excite that medium, and that could be as simple as a little flash lamp here. So this is kind of the old way of doing things. There are lots of ways of doing this. But you stimulate that medium in here, and you wind up back and forth. The light travels back and forth and bounces back and forth across these mirrored surfaces and stimulates more light to come out, and you wind up with this nice coherent stream of energy coming out, light energy coming. All right, and so let's see. We talked about this, that it's light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. All right. So in an industry, the gain medium is going to be a lot of times that an older stuff was YAG lasers. Those are still used. There are CO2 lasers, and fiber optic lasers are kind of the latest and greatest. So these are actually fiber optic cable that's doped with various elements, including some of these over here. So different gain medium. So the CO2 is actually gas. The YAG is sort of like, it says here, ytterbium aluminum garnet. It's a type of glass, essentially. Sort of like, like ruby. I guess mineral is a better word for that. But this is a solid, all right, and then the CO2 is a gas, generally traveling at high velocity, although not necessarily, but in some systems this travels at real high velocity through the resonator there. So the fiber is pretty neat because it can be a really, really long resonator. It doesn't have to be a straight line. It can actually curve, and you can wrap it up and have a coiled resonator. All right, and the light that comes out is a coherent beam, so it doesn't diverge really. It's a nice collimator focused. Well, I shouldn't say focused, but it's a nice coherent beam. But it's not a point, okay? And you can actually take that beam and focus it down, and so that's kind of critical in some applications. Is actually where you let that focal point wind up, whether it's at the surface of the material or slightly below the surface of the material. And so what the beam is doing is melting the material. In some cases, that's enough melting or even vaporizing if it's, acrylic or something like that. You're burning it completely out. If it's a metal, you're melting that material, and you still have surface tension, and sometimes you even have like oxides that get on skim on the surface of that melted metal. And what you want to do is get the blow that melted material out of the joint, or I guess I should say out of the kerf. Okay, the kerf is the material that you've removed out, the space that's being cut. All right, and so some typical considerations that you'll have when you're cutting with lasers is the absorption of the light energy by the material that you're trying to cut. All right, so if the material, for instance, in the earlier days of cutting metals with lasers, we were using like CO2 lasers, and the things like aluminum were really bad about reflecting the laser energy and not absorbing it so much. So those are factors. Also, the viscosity of the metal as it's being melted. You want it to get out of the joint there, out of the kerf, and evacuate it out. The thermal conductivity is the... as if you're having to cut slowly and things like that, you wind up with the heat energy spreading out through the metal, and sometimes that can cause issues. Also, like I said earlier, the surface tension of the molten metal as it's being melted, want to kind of retain the metal in the joint. Oxide formations, that skin that would form on the molten metal, that's particularly important in things like aluminum that form that oxide so easily. And then other things like, is that thermal expansion going to be an issue? The surface coatings and films will affect the cut. All right, so like I said, some of the older equipment still used a whole lot for like ferrous metals or CO2 lasers, which had this 10.6 micrometer or micrometer wavelength. But good for ferrous metals and could have been used for aluminum. It was used for aluminum even back in the early days. It was just a little problematic. What has tends to be a better choice in a lot of cases for these non-ferrous metals are fiber lasers, which have a much shorter wavelength. All right, and then there are these assist gases. So sometimes regular compressed shop air can be used. You can use oxygen on steel because what's going to happen is you're going to get this reactive cutting. The same reaction that you get when you're cutting with a cutting torch. All right, and we'll talk about that in just a few minutes. But if you get the metal hot enough, you can cut aluminum, or not aluminum, you can cut steel with pure oxygen. You don't need any fuel at all. The steel becomes the fuel. And nitrogen used with stainless steel and aluminum, and argon used with titanium. So I put in the lecture notes, there are some examples of some laser cutting. make sure that you're familiar with some of this, kind of what it looks like. And I'll just tell you, laser cutting produces really, really nice finishes. It's a very accurate process. You know, for what it's worth, it's really, if you're going to be cutting out along an edge like this, especially 2D cutting like this, really it's only bested by actual machining. But really the only other thing that's going to be more accurate than laser cutting, at least that comes to mind right away, is a wire EDM. So you get really nice surface finish. And generally, if all your settings are right, very little slag or dross on the back side of the cut. All right, in addition to cutting parts completely free, lasers are also used for metal removal at a more superficial level. So they're used for marking and also for texturing. So this is a maybe not the best video, but the one that I had is now gone. But there's some pretty good examples of laser mold texturing in here. Now, if you're interested in some really good nuts and bolts about actually using lasers to cut metals, these two videos, maybe about an hour long each, really are first class. So they're webinars. The audio is not great, but the content really is. So I would suggest if you're in a company that's doing laser cutting, or if you're thinking of interviewing at a place that does, or if you're in the market for buying lasers, for metal cutting purposes, these two webinars really, really are excellent. All right, now another one is plasma cutting, another thermal separating process. So I should mention that while we're talking about lasers, here in the department we have a laser cutter, but we do not have a laser cutter that will cut metal. We have a little 40-watt CO2 laser that will not cut metal of any sort. All right, so if you're laser cutting or wanting to laser cut for something like your senior project, we can laser cut up to 1/4-inch acrylic. We can cut 1/4-inch MDF and various other types of materials, wood, leather, not PVC. But if you want to cut metals, we have a plasma cutter. So please do not call this the laser cutter, as is commonly done. But it's only done by people who don't know any better. So please don't be one of those people. We have the plasma cutter. So what is a plasma cutter anyway? It uses plasma to cut. All right. So I remember being in about third or fourth grade, and we're talking about solid liquids and gases. And then the teacher said, and there's also this other thing called plasma, but it's nothing that you'll ever have anything to do with. And didn't even describe it. All right. So plasma starts off as a gas that has been heated so hot, there's so much energy in the gas that it strips it of any of the electrons, the free electrons around it. So it's ionized gas. And it's considered a whole nother state of matter. So solid, liquid, gas, and then plasma, and then of course the others that we're not going to get into. But you can take this plasma and just, it will just blast through. It's such a super high temperature gas, or not gas, but it's such a super high temperature state of matter that it just instantly burns through metal. It just will absolutely, it's just incredible to watch this stuff work. But really anything that conducts electricity usually can be plasma cut. A variety of metals can be plasma cut. Now, I've said that, but some will do better than others, okay? In terms of senior project, for our purposes, your best chance of success is 16-gauge steel. So we keep 16-gauge hot rolled, pickled, and oiled in stock. So that should be your first choice for things to plasma cut with the plasma cutter downstairs. We have a CNC plasma cutter. Thinner aluminum is probably a second choice. Thicker aluminum will cut okay. You will wind up with an awful lot of this sort of slag on the back side, and even some, in this case, on the front side of aluminum, thicker aluminum. So choose wisely. All right. So in industry, a lot of times this is actually done completely underwater, and so this is kind of adds a layer of shielding to it. But the way this works is you have this electrode in here, And this is not the greatest drawing. It looks a little bit like a TIG electrode sitting in there, but there's a swirl chamber in here that's going to spin the gases around and get them to form this kind of coherent, nice, almost like a beam of stream of compressed air coming out of here. And this arc superheats that stream of air up to the level of plasma, and you have this column of plasma that will burn through. You see images out there of, you know, this is supposed to be what the curve will look like on a plasma. And yes, if the stars are aligned, you can get some really good results. It's very common, though, if your settings are not just perfect, and with other and certain materials, you know, stainless steel, at least in my case, stainless steel is bad about making this burr on the backside. So kind of expect burrs. It is not nearly as accurate as a laser. It's a much wider kerf, and you wind up with some tapering around corners and things like that. Like I said, it's a very high temperature process. You see here the plasma arc cutting temperatures up here 50,000 Fahrenheit. So this is a video of our little plasma cutter downstairs. All right, so you've already you should have some experience with this little component that you had with your coat rack earlier in Tech 1711, and so that should give you some idea of this is almost pushing the limit of how accurately you can cut. So be familiar with that. You don't want to design a part to be plasma cut where you're going to try to cut out little 1/8 inch holes. Okay, maybe a quarter of an inch, maybe half an inch. Yeah, that will be fine. But don't try to go in and do little delicate holes. If you need holes that are precise, you'll want to go in and drill those. Now, if we were laser cutting something out like this, then you could laser cut things like that without any problem. Plasma cutter is kind of a notch down in precision. All right, a classic way to cut ferrous metals is with oxy-fuel gas cutting. All right, so this is a pretty straightforward, inexpensive way to cut metals, or cut ferrous metals, steel in particular. All right, so the whole secret to why this works so well is summed up here in this video about Travis being an idiot. So if you watch the little Travis is an idiot video, really, really good stuff. So he's got some steel wool there, and what he's doing is spinning the steel wool. All right, so what's happening is that steel is actually burning. It is combusting. It's reacting with oxygen to oxidize. Just the same way that wood does. Okay, so it is physically burning, and steel will do this. Okay, so steel will combine with oxygen, it will oxidize, it will burn, and so oxyacetylene cutting takes advantage of that. The acetylene is only there really to get the thing lit. All right, once the steel has reached what's called the kindling temperature, then the oxygen alone is all that's really needed to support the combustion. Now, typically, you keep the acetylene flowing because it's, you know, you might have to stop and restart, and it's just convenient. But if you had a cut going, you could, in theory, turn the fuel completely off and cut only with the oxygen. All right, so we'll look a little bit at some of the equipment that's needed. First of all, you have these high-pressure gas cylinders. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the acetylene cylinder in just a minute, but you should know anytime you see these gas cylinders, they are a safety hazard. They are something not to be trifled with. So the pressure in these things can be thousands of pounds per square inch, much, much higher than compressed air. And you should not try to ever do anything like remove this valve off of here. Okay, so the valve opens and closes with this, and the only thing you should be attaching or unattaching would be your pressure regulator right here at this joint. All right, so we'll talk about pressure regulators just a little bit. This is a little video of how a natural gas regulator works. That's much, much lower pressure, but still the same kind of principle. I'll talk about it just a little bit here. So here you have your high pressure inlet on your regulator, and inside here is a diaphragm, which is flexible. Okay, so this can move up and down, and attached to it is this kind of horseshoe shape. And this is all attached to that diaphragm, so this entire contraption can move up and down inside this regulator. And what happens is, if it's allowed to move up, let's just pretend there's nothing above it and it's allowed to pull up, it will shut off this outlet to the low pressure side. So if there's nothing above this diaphragm, then nothing is going to flow. Now, picture, if you will, let's just push in here with our hand. Let's pretend we've got enough energy, you know, enough force to be able to push this diaphragm down with our hand. You could see that if we were able to push it down, then air or gas would be able to flow out the outlet. All right. Well, we don't do it with our hand, but what we do have here is a spring and this pressure adjusting handle. So we'll tighten down this pressure adjusting handle and compress the spring. And that will allow gas to flow. Now, if let's just say that we have a cutting torch or something attached to this other side, and let's close the valve on the cutting torch so that material so that the pressure can't actually flow out of the outlet. What will happen is the pressure will then build up and push on the diaphragm and seal it off so that no more gas will come out to the outlet. So we can have 2,000 pounds per square inch on this side, but something low like 5 or 10 pounds per square inch on the outlet side, and that's because of the way that the pressure regulator works. All right, so notice that as you tighten this up, as you compress the spring, you are causing higher and higher pressure on the outlet side, on the low pressure side. So the safest setup for a regulator is with this pressure adjusting handle completely loose. Okay, so these will follow the right-hand rule, and you'll know which way to turn it to loosen it if you point your thumb out away from the regulator. In fact, what you can do is take, in a lot of cases, is take this pressure adjusting handle completely out. So with this very, very loose, that is the safest configuration of a regulator. As you tighten it up, you're allowing higher and higher pressure on the outlet side. Okay, so you could conceivably, if you tighten this too much, you could have enough pressure that it would burst a hose on the outlet side. All right, so let's pretend that we have this regulator installed for the first time, or we're getting ready to install this regulator for the first time. What we should do is loosen up the pressure adjusting screw so that there's no tension on the spring. And then before we attach, we want to open up this valve ever so gently and crack it. And what that's going to do is that's going to blow any kind of dust or crap that got in here during shipping or storage out of the valve here. So then after we crack it, then we'll attach this nut on here and tighten the nut down. One more time before we open the valve on top here, we're going to make sure that the pressure adjusting screw is in its loose position, and then we will gently and slowly open up the valve. Now these valves, on everything except for an acetylene tank, these tend to be double seating valves. And I will say, before I tell you many more of these instructions, is always follow the manufacturer's recommendations, not some YouTube video or even what your professor says. All right, so always consult the instruction manual for the equipment that you're using, because sometimes there are little differences. All right, so we attach this. We'll get this good and snug. Now, we don't want to ever use any kind of grease or oil or even Teflon tape. We don't want to use any hydrocarbons at all in this system. We never want to grease this or oil it. And why not? Well, if we were to open that inlet, that valve quickly, and the pressure builds up quickly in here, you might be familiar with a concept like a diesel engine, this adiabatic heating, and it can reach combustion temperatures. And if you have inside here grease or oil, then you have hydrocarbons, you have fuel, and you have oxygen, and not just air. So you have pure oxygen and fuel and enough energy to initiate a reaction. And you can cause an explosion. You can burn out a regulator with that. And so regulator burnout can happen from that. It can also happen just on older regulator styles, just by opening that valve too fast. Okay, so never stand right in front of a regulator when you're opening the valve. Always open the valve slowly and never use grease or oil on any of these fittings. All right, there are also other bad things that can happen with cutting and welding with gas. All right, so one of those things is to have flashback, where you have flames that actually travel back up into the torch. You want to make sure that you're using equipment that has, let's see if I can find one here. Yeah, that has check valves and back flashback arrestors like you see here. All right, so generally you want to make sure that you're not using really, really antiquated equipment, and you want to make sure that you are reading the instruction manual for the equipment that you're using. All right, and then the torch, it says welding torch, that's so you can do welding with oxyacetylene, but also cutting. The tip size in either of these is important. So the tip size is going to be related to the thickness of the metal that you're trying to cut or weld if you're talking about welding. All right, these are some various fuels. I want to just briefly mention on this slide about the importance of the difference in knowing between the importance of knowing the difference between temperature and heat. All right, so you can heat up a, let's just say, a flame or a piece of metal to a certain temperature, but heat is another property altogether. Okay, so the way to kind of start to think about this is, you know, if you walk across the floor and you on a cold winter day when the air is really dry, and you touch the light switch and you get a little shock, the temperature of that little spark is really pretty high, but it doesn't really burn you because there's not much heat there. Okay, so another way to think of this is if you have a lighter, okay, the temperature of the lighter is pretty high. If you touch the flame of a lighter, you're going to burn yourself. But if you're trying to heat a whole room, you want to use something like a radiator that has a bigger quantity of heat coming out of it. So some fuels will burn at a higher temperature. You see here acetylene up here at the top. Okay, it's very popular for that. But you can get a higher quantity of heat overall available out of a gas, that is the number of BTUs per cubic foot, out of other gases like a MAP gas, for instance. So think of a BTU. Remember, the definition of a BTU is the amount of energy that it takes to raise a, what is it, a pound of water 1 Fahrenheit degree. Okay, so that's a good way to think of heat. And so this is the number of BTUs available in a cubic foot of gas, which is all I've always thought is kind of a weird way to measure a quantity of gas, but it's like a cubic foot of gas at atmospheric pressure. All right, now if we're going to talk about oxyacetylene cutting, it's very good idea to talk about the dangers of acetylene. I'm not going to talk too much about the dangers of oxygen, although oxygen can be extremely dangerous. All right, it seems, you know, it's essential to life, but if you get a really high concentration of oxygen in a small area, then the most the least kind of flammable substance, or say you have a cotton shirt and a lot of oxygen in a small room with cotton, it will go from not just burning, but to burning extremely fast, and just a very dangerous thing. You know, you probably know about the Apollo 1 accident that happened because they were in an oxygen-rich environment, which really does, which makes fires become something altogether different. All right, so oxygen is dangerous, but acetylene is a bomb waiting to go off. Okay, so acetylene, this formula here, can actually explode. It can decompose explosively, even just in the cylinder by itself with nothing but carbon and hydrogen in that cylinder, nothing but acetylene in the cylinder. If it is shocked, or if it reaches a pressure that's too high, then you can initiate essentially an explosion in an acetylene cylinder. Now, to prevent, and this is anytime you get acetylene above 15 psi, it becomes susceptible to this reaction. So acetylene cylinders have got a special accommodation for this. They have this porous media in here that's soaked in acetone. Okay, and so the acetylene will go into this, and it will absorb into the acetone the same way that CO2 dissolves into soda. All right, so it's very important that this structure, that you're using an actual acetylene cylinder to store acetylene. You never want to do something like store acetylene to charge up something like a Freon tank or something. All right, when you're using an oxyacetylene setup, you should know that there are three different types of flames: a carburizing flame, a neutral flame, and an oxidizing flame. So when you first light up, what you're typically going to do is turn the oxygen completely off and light with just acetylene. So that will give you this big, bright, long flame. And there will be an abundance of leftover carbon. In fact, the glowing orange that you see is actually little carbon particles that have been heated up till they incandesce. And you'll actually see carbon streams floating around through the air. And what you'll do is then start adding oxygen, and eventually you'll get to this stage here where you still have an excess of carbon coming, from the flame. So there's leftover carbon in this flame, so it's called a carburizing flame. And if you were to take this flame and brush it up against some steel, it'll just make it black with soot, all right? And you keep, what you want to do is watch. What you're typically wanting is this neutral flame here, okay? So you'll add oxygen, and this little interior flame called the neutral, or the acetylene feather, is going to start to collapse down onto this cone, and you'll see this pretty clearly. It's a lot easier to see than it is to photograph. So you'll dial this in, start adding oxygen just until this little acetylene feather collapses down and disappears onto this interior cone here, which has a nice rounded shape to it. And the result will be this neutral flame. Okay, so this is a carburizing flame. This is a neutral flame. But if you keep adding oxygen, then you'll wind up with an oxidizing flame, okay? And so you'll hear this. It's a little bit easier to hear this than it is to see it even. But if you're watching, different torches will do a little different shape. But if you've got a welding torch, typically it will kind of come back and sharpen that cone up a little bit. Sometimes it'll extend out a little bit longer, but you'll hear it, and you'll know that you've gone beyond and that you're now in an oxidizing flame. All right, I put in the notes a little safety with cutting with oxyfuel, a little video in there. I do want to make sure that you watch that. I will try to make that assigned separately before we do the welding and cutting lab. You do need to know how to light a cutting torch before you come to lab. Okay, so understand about the regulators. Understand that the pressure that you set the oxygen and acetylene tanks to, or the regulators to, is going to depend on the thickness of the metal that you're trying to cut and the nozzle that you have installed. And you can only get real good numbers for this. You know, you can kind of guesstimate, but this is really not something you should be guesstimating with. But what you want is your manufacturer's recommendations for this particular cutting tip. So you've got this particular tip, maybe it's a 00 tip. Your manufacturer that you bought this from, in this case I think it's a Victor set, will recommend a certain PSI for the acetylene, a certain PSI for the oxygen. Now, you'll notice on the tip that there are two different sets of orifices here, okay? You have the outside set. Those are going to be your preheat nozzles, okay? And the inside is going to be for pure oxygen. So what you're looking at on this torch, notice that there are three knobs. There's one here, and then there's one here for each of the fuel and the oxygen. So the oxygen hose is the green, the fuel hose is the red. And for cutting, what you want to do is open this oxygen valve up completely. All right, so let's assume that you already have the regulators set. Open this valve up completely, and you should hear a little hissing. If you don't hear a hissing, then open this valve up and then close it back, okay? Because you want everything to be quiet at this point. So what this valve is the preheat oxygen. All right, so I'll lay this on here, all right? So even though I said that the oxygen needs to be open completely, it should only be open right here, okay? And what that will do, that will allow the oxygen to make it all the way to this preheat valve. Now, in this situation, let's say the preheat valve is completely closed. Then we could allow oxygen to flow by depressing this lever, and that would send oxygen straight through. It'll bypass this preheat valve, and it'll send it straight through the top here and out through that hole, that center orifice. All right. Then you'll start adding fuel until it kind of stops smoking a little bit. Then you'll start to add preheat oxygen, and this is where you'll balance out that neutral flame. Okay, so you'll start adding enough preheat oxygen, and then you're ready to start cutting. So you bring this up to the edge of the metal, bring the metal up to the kindling temperature, and you'll kind of recognize that it will turn kind of a nice bright orange color, and then depress this lever, and it will start blowing out the oxygen, and blowing out hopefully an abundance of sparks out the backside. And if you move at the right rate, and that's really where the trick is, moving at the right rate to get a good cut. Okay, I will say the other trick really is using the right size nozzle for the metal that you're trying to cut. So make sure that you use your manufacturer's recommendations there. If you hear a loud popping noise, then you have probably bumped off and touched this to the surface of the material, and you've had a little flashback. Don't do that. Okay, if you hear a popping noise and then you hear followed by a strong hissing sound, then you need to shut everything down because you've got backflash, you've got flames traveling back up into the torch, which is something you don't want. All right, so be familiar with that kind of stuff ahead of time. Like I said earlier, oxyfuel can be used to cut really, really thick shapes. So this is a really nice big chunk that's being cut. And it's, man, it's just an old standby. It's old reliable. There are other variants of this, okay? So steel does just great with oxyacetylene. There's some stainless steels and other ferrous metals that don't fare so well. And there is this sort of workaround that adds iron powder as a fuel. Okay, so that's called powder cutting. I think it's just kind of interesting. There's some other kind of related processes like oxygen lances that are used to pierce big thick pieces of metal, and also broco rods are used a lot in underwater cutting. So I've a broco rod is really just it's like a tube that has some rods in it. It's an electrode and an oxygen nozzle at the same time. And so underwater, you can take and touch the end of that broco rod off, and it will initiate the oxygen. You're pumping oxygen through it. I'll just go out and grab the patent there. So you have these rods, and then you have, this is usually like a copper tube and then electrical tape around that, and you're pumping oxygen through this bundle of rods, and the electricity initiates a reaction, initiates the flame, and then the oxygen does the actual combusting of the metal and blasts it out of the way. All right, so that is, I think that's all for this lecture. Kind of a lot of stuff jammed into one lecture, but hopefully you guys are breaking these up a little bit throughout your day. We'll see you next time.